for the Food for Peace organization. I want to give you a little background on how the Food for Peace organization got developed. In the platform which I show you here, in the LaRouche Atlanta platform draft, called Mastering the Grave Crisis of 1989 to 1992, Lyndon LaRouche develops a critical point in this platform. The point he makes is that the Soviet Union, at this moment in time, has gone through a military buildup which goes under the name of perestroika. They have been going through this for the last 6 years. This military buildup has caused enormous crisis inside the Soviet Union, as you're seeing erupting in Uzbekistan, Turkestan, throughout the Estonia, Lithuania, Latvia. You see it erupting particularly in Poland, Romania, and other places. Do not be fooled. This is not a wave of democratization, as I will go through in some detail. What is occurring in the Soviet Union and its satellite countries is the most massive looting since the Stalin period. This looting was done to build up the Soviet war-winning capability. But it, since that got put back by 2 years because of the Chernenko interim, they are now at the point where that kind of looting, that level of looting, is causing massive social crisis inside the East Bloc itself. When we say food for peace, this is not some abstraction. This is not some utopian dream of liberals or one-worlders. When we say food for peace, we mean very precisely that unless the world produces significantly more food, not just for the Soviet Union, but for starving people in the Sudan region, in Bangladesh, and around the world, then the kind of social dislocation that the disastrous drought has brought on and the fall in food reserves has brought on will literally be the basis upon which the Soviets would be tempted, because of the internal social crisis, to use their war capability to take food in order to stabilize their own situation. So when we say food for peace, it is not an abstraction. When Mr. LaRouche indicated in his Atlanta platform that if we do not solve this crisis, the Soviets could be tempted and would be tempted to use their military to take food. Therefore, the question before us is, the food issue is probably the most security-sensitive issue in the world today. And therefore, we must solve this crisis. And toward that, an international organization called Food for Peace was formed in Chicago on September 15th. And we are having a major meeting on December 10th, which will bring together a much larger force to ram through the kinds of policies that will stabilize the situation. Otherwise, we are facing war and genocide. And let me go through the situation within the Soviet bloc, because the reality is that these 2 years of buildup have created a very unstable situation inside the Soviet Union itself. There was recently a study done of 140 villages, a survey, inside the Soviet Union. Most of them are out of meat, fish, and dairy products, and sugar increasingly has not been seen. In fact, what you see in Moscow now is something that has never been seen before. People are coming from villages to lines inside Moscow, which are increasing massively, because they cannot get food in their own home villages. This, in this survey, has been shown to be the case also in the Ukraine, which is the traditional breadbasket of the whole Soviet Union. Now, the estimate, and these are people who know, and we're not talking about official Soviet estimates, but we're talking about people who actually have been in Uzbekistan have told us that the average person in that area has maybe 30 kilograms of meat a year. That means 66 pounds of meat per year. That is less than 1 pound, a little more than 1 pound a week. Even in Moscow, and these are official Soviet statistics, the average person only has 2 pounds of meat. Now, this includes the bureaucrats, which obviously have 7 or 8 pounds of meat a week, and others who go way below that. In reality, the Soviets need 225 metric tons of grain, million metric tons of grain per year. Their own estimate was that they produced maybe 205 million metric tons. Now, what that means in the Soviet Union, and we have fairly accurate estimates of this, although I personally have not seen these estimates, we know for a fact that much of the grain does not even get into the storage area because of slow harvest, because there is no incentive to harvest quickly, and the breakdown in transportation. So that in reality, we're talking about maybe 190 million metric tons that will in fact be used in the Soviet Union. In 1979, the Soviets imported 30 million metric tons. In 1981 and 82, where they had a disastrous harvest, they imported 55 million metric tons. In 1987-88, they're going to import 40 million metric tons, and next year we do not even know, because of the disastrous harvest, what they will intend to import. As you know, the American taxpayer subsidizes every ounce of grain, every pat of butter that goes to the Soviet Union. But in reality, if we look at the living standards of the citizens in the Soviet Union, an average wage is roughly 200 rubles a month. Now, if you're going to buy a kilogram of cooked sausage, it basically will cost 2.9 rubles if you can get it at a state shop. Increasingly, this is not being seen at the state shops. Therefore, they have to go on the black market. The black market for such a kilogram of sausage costs 9 to 11 rubles, which is roughly the equivalent of a filet steak in any Western European country. If a worker intends to have any meat on the table, roughly 2 pounds a week, he will have to spend 20% of his total monthly income to get 2 pounds of meat on the table a week. What is worse is that the situation inside Eastern Europe has increased in the most exorbitant way. The head of the Soviet agriculture, a man by the name of Agan Begin, indicated that 17% of the families inside the Soviet Union do not have their own apartments. And half of the apartments inside the Soviet Union have no toilets, no sewage, and no running water. Now, how does the Soviet Union, as bad as that is, how has the Soviet Union survived? What they have done is they have looted Eastern Europe. The figures are very clear. East Germany has increased its exports to the Soviet Union by 23%. Czechoslovakia has increased its exports to the Soviet Union by 46%. Poland by 55%. Hungary by 32%. Romania by 68%. And Bulgaria by 53%. As I show you on this chart here, it just indicates the level of looting that is going on inside the East Bloc to feed the Soviet Union. And if you see this bottom line here, where it says imports, imports from the Soviet Union have remained absolutely flat. The major import that occurs is in the area of oil. Now you get the real picture. Even though the charts, denominated in rubles, say that the imports have remained flat from 1981, this is the true reality. That in 1981, 8 billion koruny, which is a Czechoslovakian currency, would buy X amount of oil. The same amount of oil in 1986 was bought for 23 billion koruny, which means that the Soviets arbitrarily increased the price of oil, which tripled the cost. Now, if you understand that, on the one hand, you see massive increases of inflow from the East Bloc to the Soviet Union. And on the other hand, while it looks flat, they have decreased the flow of oil out, even though they get paid the same amount. So Eastern Europe is in an incredible bind, and that is what is causing the explosions. Do not believe the Western press when they say glasnost and the wave of democratization is causing this. We see that in Poland most directly. What is occurring in Poland, which I will go through, is that they are now exporting milk, which they do not have, to make up some money to pay back their debt. On the other side, and this is what I'm going to go through now, on the other side, Poland now is in an incredible crisis, because what we have is, and this is the debt service that is paid to Western banks. In other words, Eastern Europe is being looted by the Soviet Union, but they are also being looted by the IMF. 47% of Hungary's total exports go to pay merely debt service, not principal, on their debt owed to the Western banks. 30% of Bulgaria's total exports go to pay the same debt service. 71% of all of Poland's exports go to pay debt service. What this means is very, very devastating. For instance, let me go through some of the statistics. Romania used to owe $11 billion. Now they reduced their debt by $5 billion. But they've wiped out one quarter of the villages in Romania. In Yugoslavia, they used to owe $21 billion in 1981. By massive internal looting and by borrowing, they now owe $20 billion, even though they have paid roughly $13 billion in merely interest payments. Now, Poland is the most severe situation. Through total looting of their own economy, they were able to get their exports over their imports, $1.2 billion in 1985 and $1 billion in 1986. This did not even pay the interest on the debt which is owed. So how did Poland pay that interest? What they did was Poland in 1987 exported 84% of their processed foods. Agricultural exports in Poland increased by 62%, but there was no increase in production. It's the same situation we have in Brazil, where they do not have enough food to feed their own people. Yet in order to pay their debt, they are destroying, internally looting themselves to such a degree that the infant mortality in Poland is now up to 18 deaths per thousand. This compares with the United States, which has 11 deaths per thousand children, and compares with Japan, which has 7 deaths per thousand children. What Poland is doing is exporting their milk, and therefore they do not have enough formula for the children of Poland in order to pay that debt. So do not have any illusions about what is going on in the East Bloc. The same is true of Hungary. 70% of their export earnings go to pay the debt. It's the most vicious austerity we have ever seen. And the situation is completely explosive. In response to this, what have we done? What has the Western nations done? As you know, we've gone through one of the worst droughts in American history in the last year. What is coming up now is the GATT negotiations in Montreal. Now, these GATT negotiations are for the first time going to take up, presumably in a serious way, agricultural exports. Now, the policy of the United States at this meeting is, and I quote President Reagan on this, quote, "The heart of our proposal is the elimination of all export subsidies, all barriers to each other's markets, including tariffs and quotas, and all domestic subsidies that affect trade." And the U.S. Trade Representative Clayton Yoder, who is mooted to be the next agricultural secretary, which would be a total disaster, is going to push such a policy at the GATT negotiations. What they intend to do in a period where the United States food production is at the lowest ebb, in which our stocks now of food are at an incredibly low ebb, the GATT negotiations are saying we're in an overproduction crisis. They say that we have produced too much food, and therefore we must increasingly, through the cuts in subsidies, through cuts in all sorts of pricing help, we must reduce the amount of food we produce. This is completely insane. They are also calling for a 12% set-aside. This is mad. Even the FAO, which is the which is connected to the UN, has said that our stocks have fallen so badly that we have to increase overall stocks of food by roughly 220 million more tons of grain, and they are no friends of the farmer. But yet, in the GATT negotiations, they are still screaming about overproduction. Now, I have a chart here which is somewhat startling. This chart here will show how much land we have taken out of production, and in 1988, which you do not see, it will get worse. This is conscious policy of the GATT negotiators. This is a conscious policy of the grain cartels. What they intend to do is, by taking away the food subsidies prices, they intend to throw farmers off the land. 80,000 farmers will receive this month letters in which they will be told that they, through the FMHA, cannot have to reorganize their debt. At least 37,000 farmers will be thrown off their land by the end of this year. This, in the worst drought and probably the worst strategic crisis in our history. Therefore, when we say food for peace, we mean very precisely that if any farmer gets thrown off the land, this is a national security question. If we do not produce food in the quantity that we need to feed both the developing sector and also the Soviet Union, then we are facing the worst strategic crisis in our history. When we say food for peace, this is not an abstraction. We mean very precisely, if food is not produced, if these farmers are not kept on their land, if they are not given the parity price that they need to keep on their land and keep producing food, then there will be World War III. This is not an abstraction. This is not a utopian fantasy of food for peace, as Truman had proposed, because he was a one-worlder. We are talking very precisely about either there will be food or there will be war. That is the issue that we are facing. Now, the question of political will comes up in this, because there have been many attempts to pull farm organizations together. Two things that the Food for Peace are doing, which has never been done before. One, at the December 10th meeting, we will have farmers from every continent on this planet. Already, we have made some progress. We know for a fact that the GATT negotiations have been so targeted by our organization internationally that already Reagan has made some sane backoffs from a total free trade approach because of the fear of the strategic situation. So already we've had some effect. Also, the recent pronouncements by the FAO of a need for increase in production is useful, and in large part has been done by our screaming about the issue. But something more is needed. In the next 90 days, President-elect Bush is going to have to determine what policies is going to follow. It is now the time that we must act decisively and make the policies clear that he must follow. The problem, as all farmers know, and most people know, we are facing an economic crisis. He must act decisively to stabilize the world monetary system and create a condition in which the developing sector nations can buy food because they desperately need it, and it will be important for our own farms and our own manufacturers to have such a good situation in the developing sector. In fact, I would say, even without the drought, unless we deal with the economic crisis in a very decisive way that is about to happen, this will be more devastating to agricultural production than any drought in history. That's one of the proposals we have to deal with. But the real question is the issue of political will. And this is very much tied to an important issue which I think we have to face. Many people think that maybe there is nothing we can do. And yet, the principle of tragedy must become a very important issue which people begin to think about. Because what happens in a tragedy? In all classical tragedy, what occurs is that all the characters in the tragedy have some flaw. This flaw, in the beginning of the tragedy, is defined. At a critical point in the tragedy, the flaws become extremely apparent. But they do, in a moment, realize that the implications of their tragedy are much broader than a mere disaster for themselves, but a disaster for whole nations, a disaster for people all around them. And they actually being able to see this large disaster, think for a moment, and yet they go back to what they had been doing before. Whole nations have been wiped out because people did not change the way they act. This is particularly apparent in the great tragedy, Hamlet. What happens in the tragedy, and I'll just go through a little background in the story, is that Hamlet, in the beginning, is told by a ghost, who happens to be his own father, that the nation of Denmark is being run by a murderer, who happened to be Hamlet's uncle and his father's brother. This murderer has taken Hamlet's mother as his wife. This is a disastrous situation for the nation and a personally disastrous moral situation for Hamlet. Hamlet first acts insane so that no one knows what his plan is. Not a wise decision, in my opinion. But what occurs later is even worse. When he tricks the king to admitting that, in fact, he did kill his father, Hamlet has a chance to act, and he refuses. And everything in the play unravels from there. And at the end is one of the most bloody scenes in all tragedies. Hamlet stands there in a play at swords, in which he himself is mortally wounded because of the poison that was put on his sword. What happens is, at that point, realizing, he kills, finally, his father. Also, his mother is killed because she drinks a poison cup. And everybody on the stage, the whole nation, the whole leadership of a nation, is wiped out because he refused to act at the point that he could have to change the situation. In essence, we must act now. There will not be another chance. We must look at reality in the face. And in that way, we must reflect on the issue of Gethsemane, which was developed in the New Testament, in which Christ, facing the responsibility, asked the cup to be taken from him. And at the same moment, he realizes there is no one to take the cup from him, and he says, "Thy will be done." That kind of responsibility for the human species is the kind of responsibility that the people who are watching this tape must take. If we take that responsibility to tell other people and organize other people, we can change the course of history. We're going to be dealing with seismic crisis, things that will wake people up. But you who are watching this tape must take this responsibility. If you do take that responsibility, we will be able to change the course of history and save the nation and the world from total chaos. Thank you. My name is Jerry Rose. I'm speaking to you from Food for Peace.
Being used as a weapon against peoples who have proven troublesome to Moscow. Famine is engineered deliberately in the North Caucasus, the Volga Basin, and Ukraine. The Soviet secret police seal off Ukraine's borders. No one can get out or bring food in. A nation the size of France is strangled by hunger. In less than 2 years, 10 million people die. 7 million of them in Ukraine. 3 million of them children.
This is the most terrible thing I've ever seen. It precisely because of the deliberation with which it was done and the total absence of even any kind of sympathy.
If you revive this terrible past, and you are always shaken again, and it moves you again, and you can't get rid of these terrible pictures you have seen or these terrible reports you have gotten in this period.
Nearest city was 40 miles, so I walked about once a week or so to that city. I could buy for my salary two loaves of bread a month. So that's only how we could survive. But the peasants were dying.
This was the first time in my life that I saw people dying. And of course it was very hard.
Thank you.
The untold story of Ukraine's darkest tragedy begins at a time of great optimism and joy in March 1917. A tidal wave of revolution sweeps aside the mighty Tsarist Empire. National boundaries change rapidly with the dramatic shifting of power. Ukrainians grasp the chance to reclaim their independence after 200 years of Russian domination. Kiev, Ukraine's ancient capital, is once again the seat of government. Ukraine's rich and fertile land has supplied Europe with grain for countless generations. Even the ancient Greeks depended on her abundant stores of wheat. History has taught Ukraine that freedom has a price. The people prepare to defend their national republic against all invaders. December 1917. Having consolidated Bolshevik control in Russia, Lenin prepares to reclaim the former Tsarist territories. In four ensuing years of chaos, Ukrainians fight Lenin's Red Army, Denikin's White Army, Germans, Poles. Whether the armies march in as enemies or allies, the price is always measured in tons of food. This bountiful country is slowly bled dry. 1921. The dust of battle finally settles. Russia has retaken a major part of the country. Western Ukraine is carved up between Poland, Romania, and Czechoslovakia. The Soviet conquerors ship out more and more grain to feed Moscow. A drought adds to Ukraine's misery. Millions die as the breadbasket of Europe experiences its first famine. Yet this is but a preview of the tragedy to follow. To end the continued resistance to Bolshevik rule, Lenin adopts a new economic policy. Grain requisitions are canceled. The peasant farmer is allowed to trade freely on the open market. The impact on Ukraine is dynamic. 80% of her population are farmers. Hoping to win further support, Lenin tolerates the national revival which has been gathering momentum since the 1917 revolution in Kiev. Ukraine's blossoming renaissance is so powerful, Lenin's successor, Stalin, views the loss of Russian influence with increasing alarm. Ivan Maestrenko was a Marxist instructor of journalism in Soviet Ukraine.
A meeting of the Politburo heard a report that students in Kiev no longer know how to speak Russian. Everyone was shocked. How can that be, they asked. Well, in Ukrainian schools during the 20s, the Russian language was treated like French, German, etc., as a foreign language. And that's why students who came from Ukrainian schools didn't know Russian. And not knowing Russian constituted a clear threat that Kiev would become the capital of an independent Ukraine.
Thousands of Ukrainian language parishes spring up across the country. For the first time since the 17th century, the Ukrainian Orthodox Church re-establishes its independence from the Moscow Patriarchate. In the arts, the flourishing avant-garde models itself on Western, not Russian, culture. Literary circles abound. Writers and poets develop a uniquely Ukrainian literature. Ukraine's leading communist writer, Mykola Khmelyovey, elaborates on the dangerous slogan, "Away from Moscow." Even the leader of the Ukrainian Communist Party, Mykola Skripnik, sees the USSR as a kind of League of Nations and argues for greater cultural and political autonomy to win Ukrainians over to communism.
Mykola Skripnik really saw himself as an equal to Stalin, as an independent national ruler. I mean, when he went to Moscow, he'd take a translator, even though he spoke perfect Russian. He tried with some success to establish a cultural protectorate over Ukrainian communities in Russia. He even called for the direct annexation of border areas with the majority of Ukrainians to Soviet Ukraine. So he was actually making territorial demands against Stalin.
By 1928, Stalin is a law unto himself. This efficient, ruthless administrator has eliminated all effective opposition within the Politburo. The dream of a worldwide communist revolution has not materialized. As Stalin strengthens communism within the borders of the USSR, Russian nationalism is increasingly injected into his policies. The strong cultural individuality of Ukraine is no longer tolerated. 1929. Stalin strikes at the nation's heart and mind, its church and intelligentsia. Over the next few years, the systematic liquidation of intellectuals is carried out by the communist regime in Ukraine. 5,000 scholars, scientists, poets, and artists prominent during Ukraine's independence are arrested for allegedly belonging to the SVU, a secret organization the Soviets claim is planning an armed insurrection. Only 45 get a public trial. No evidence is considered necessary. Thousands upon thousands are imprisoned, deported, and executed later as mass arrests continue throughout the 30s. Even the church is accused of involvement in this alleged plot.
Many priests were arrested. Many were sent to Siberian concentration camps. Many shot. My father was one of them. He never came back. I know this from personal experience. 30 bishops were martyred. Thousands of priests were perished. 100,000 of faithful were liquidated. Metropolitan Vasilip Kivsky and his two successors were arrested too. To this day, we don't know what happened to them.
Церкви було повно людей.
The church was full of people.
На конях заїхали.
Some communists rode inside on horseback and ordered me to undress.
Це березень місяць.
It was March.
На дворі сніг.
There was snow outside.
Я у мештах.
The snow was melting, and I walked in water up to my knees while they rode on horseback.
На конях.
They interrogated me, but I didn't answer their questions. And for this, I was rewarded with pistol blows across my back.
They began taking down the icons and smashing them on the ground. The people wanted to go inside the church, but they didn't let them. They ruined everything, smashed everything in the church. And the people stood outside crying because they couldn't do anything. When a man went up to remove the bell, and that bell fell to the ground and rang out, all the people burst into tears. Everyone was weeping and saying goodbye to the bell, because that was the last time that bell rang.
By 1930, only the Russian Orthodox Church remains. In October 1928, Stalin introduces a drastic five-year plan to transform the Soviet Union from a backward rural society into a modern, self-sufficient industrial empire virtually overnight. Military defense takes priority. Socialism must be protected from all future enemies. Western technology is urgently needed. To pay for it, Stalin must seize the only exportable resource, grain. And so he decrees the compulsory collectivization of agriculture. Henceforth, all private lands, livestock, and farming implements will belong to the state. The farmer will work as a laborer for pay, like a worker in a factory.
One of the intriguing elements in the Ukraine was that it brought together both the peasant question and the nationality question in a way that was somewhat different than in other areas. Because in the Ukraine, Ukrainians tended to concentrate in rural areas, and in the city areas, particularly in the eastern Ukraine, it was Russian and Jewish populations that dominated. So that any policies that the Bolsheviks adopted toward the peasants had an obvious impact on Ukrainians very directly.
With the destruction of the intellectuals and the church well underway, collectivization allows Stalin to break the farmers, the backbone of the nation. Anticipating fierce resistance, he orders the liquidation of the kulaks as a class. Kulak is a Bolshevik label for the wealthier farmers who own 24 acres of land or hire labor. They are considered the potential leaders in any revolt. The state confiscates not only the lands of the farmers, classified as kulaks, but also all their possessions. It is forbidden by law to assist these enemies of the people. Miroslava Vutka was 7 when her father was exiled. She never saw him again.
In the winter of 1931, they came to evict us from our house. Activists, a group of people, if they could be called people, came into the house and looked over everything and made us very frightened. Then they said, "Get out. This isn't your house anymore." But mother wouldn't leave. "At least let us spend the rest of the winter here," she begged. "Where can I go with these children and old people?" The men picked her up and threw her outside. A militiaman or activist stood in the doorway as a guard. Mother shouted to us, "Children, don't leave the house." There were tears and screams. It was frightening. We grabbed hold of the benches in the house, screaming and refusing to let go. Then the men began to take us out one by one. They would throw one of us outside and then another. Thus, they threw us out of the house, one by one, all 6 of us.
A courageous neighbor risked deportation to give her family shelter. Some farmers burn their crops, kill their livestock, and flee to the cities. But over the next 3 years, 1 million men, women, and children are rounded up, jammed into sealed boxcars, and shipped off to the remotest corners of the Soviet Union. Survivors work as slave labor, producing raw materials for export to the West. This is the end of the line for many of the best farmers and cultural and religious leaders of Ukraine. Thank you. party activists are brought in from the cities to push through collectivization. Anyone who opposes the measures is denounced as a kulak and deported. Yet resistance comes from all quarters. Not so long ago, the Bolsheviks had given land to the poor. Now they want to take it away.
Thank God I didn't kill anyone. I didn't have anyone put away. I didn't inform on anyone. But I wrote. I was an agitator. I attended meetings and also told the peasants, bring in the grain. Hand over the grain. The workers have nothing to eat. There's a world crisis. Hitler has taken over in Germany. The Japanese are advancing into Manchuria. Our country is a fortress that's surrounded by enemies on all sides. And I yelled and begged and swore and threatened, of course. Anyone who doesn't bring in grain had better watch out for the punishing sword of the proletarian dictatorship. Well, I rattled on, as we all did, and believed that it was necessary. My father was very much against collectivization. He said they were ruining the village, that the Bolsheviks knew nothing about farm management, that even the old landlords were better managers than the Soviet district officials. But when you're 18 or 20 years old, who believes his father?
In 1930, Petro Grigorenko was one of the many students brought in from the cities to harvest the grain.
There was rebellion, then sabotage. People did not give up. They attacked the local authorities, usually not killing anyone. They only tied them up and threw them into a barn or simply drove them from the village. And they took back their property, took back their horses, cows, and implements, which had just been taken by the collective. They would take all that back. To crush the rebellions, troops were sent in. They would shoot over the people's heads, but they would also shoot at their heads and their hearts.
Vasily Sokil witnessed a squad of GPU secret police attacking a lone, defiant farmer.
They formed a wide circle around the house. When they realized that the farmer inside had no more bullets left, they threw a grenade into the attic. After that, everything fell silent. The fact of that armed resistance burned itself into my memory. I saw that even under those terrible conditions, there were people who believed in fighting for the right to live as the Ukrainian farmer had always lived.
The wheat is left standing in the fields. The demoralized farmers respond to the ruinous taxes and the presence of troops by simply refusing to work. The grain quotas or taxes are deliberately raised to exceed what the individual farmers can possibly produce. Either they join the collectives where the taxes are three times lower or face exile as kulaks. By mid-1932, three-quarters of all Ukrainian farms are collectivized. Then, in August, crippling new quotas are levied on the collectives themselves. Another exorbitant quota is levied in October, and yet another at the beginning of the new year. These levies are impossible to meet.
The working people were getting rationing card, and they could get food from the warehouse in the village. Like 1 liter of milk and 2 pounds of bread for a week. But the farmers, the peasants, they could not get anything any place. And so they had nothing to eat right away the second day after those people from government took everything from them.
The regime blames the farmers for the stringent food rationing in the cities. In reality, the Soviets are dumping tons of wheat on Western markets. The 1932 harvest yields enough grain to have fed the entire population of Ukraine for 2 years. Instead, famine ravages the country.
It was a spoken order. Stalin gave it. That there was a definite plan, I knew from the instructions given us by Stanislav Kosior, the secretary of the Communist Party of Ukraine. He said, the Kulak wants to crush our Soviet government with the bony hand of famine. We will bend this bony hand back on the throat of the Kulak.
The Russians came from house to house and took all the foods that people had in the house, starting with grain, flour, wheat, or what, barley, or whatever they had, up to the last drop of the food. They took the beets, the beans, potatoes, whatever they had in cellars or in the house. And besides that, they didn't trust them. They started searching the houses, looking all over, digging in the house, in holes in the floors, digging in the ovens, ruining their ovens. And so they went from house to house and took everything from peasants.
'31, the farmers crowd into the cities, selling heirlooms, anything, in order to buy the bread they themselves have produced. An internal passport system is introduced to deliberately confine them to their villages. 1932, Stalin condemns the Ukrainian party's urgent appeals to reduce quotas and send aid. He accuses them of placing local interests above the success of the five-year plan. The war for bread is the war for socialism, he says. Stalin's trusted envoy, Pavel Postyshev, is given sweeping dictatorial powers and sent into Ukraine with an army of secret police to purge the Ukrainian party ranks and to squeeze out the last kernels of grain. 112,000 trusted party members from Russia are now stationed in Ukraine. They guard the standing crops and livestock from the starving, brutally enforcing the law to protect state property.
This was a horrible law. If they saw a child picking a stalk of wheat, trying to eat those unripe grains, that was a very serious crime. This was a government order to punish anyone, even to death by execution.
Not only do all state quotas have to be met, but additional grain has to be set aside for seed and livestock before the collective farm workers get paid. 80% of the collectives fail to pay their workers anything at all. And a new draconian measure prevents the workers from searching for work elsewhere.
The collective farm where my father worked had stood since 1928. It was a good, strong farm. But although this was the best farm around, it was suffering even more than the others because they were disciplined and had everything organized on time. While government trucks would pull right up to the winnowing machines and take everything. They even took the chaff. My father was already swollen. Not too much, but his feet were swollen and his eyes, all in the typical look of starvation. And in the house, there was nothing left but half a pumpkin, and that's all. I went to the collective farm to get horses. There, a friend of mine from the Communist Youth League said weakly, you came to take your father away? Well, take him. Maybe he'll survive. But it's too late for us.
Она уже не выжить. Да.
Village mothers, dying of hunger, throw their children onto trains heading into the cities in the desperate hope someone will take pity and feed them.
I entered the car, railroad car, and then I saw it was full of children. Some of them were enormously thin, but others were thin at the top of the body, but their legs were and stomachs were enormously swollen. Some of them had convulsions. In general, if a child was lying very quietly, we already knew this child will die soon.
During the day, people would hide. You couldn't see them anywhere. But at night they would come out, like shadows, lining up in front of the bread stores, hoping maybe to get some bread in the morning. Only homeless children could be seen walking in the streets. Homeless children and starving women in rags and dead bodies, children stepping over them. That's how the city of Kharkiv looked.
It is hard to imagine how long those lines were for the so-called commercial bread. They lined up by the thousand, or two, or three, and even as many as 7,000.
Andor Henke was the German consul stationed in Kiev. He and his family witnessed the horrors of the famine firsthand.
I ran out of the consulate because the Russian newspapers were reporting that there was a famine in Germany, but that everything was wonderful in Russia. I became very angry and took pictures of the corpses.
I still have a very vivid memory of that time in Kiev. We were children at the time. My sister was 4 years younger than I. We lived in the consulate like in a golden cage. We weren't allowed to go out in the streets alone during this time. Nevertheless, I remember the misery and the famine very well. I remember seeing bodies everywhere, in doorways, on street corners. Wagons would take them away. They were picked up, thrown in, and driven away. Some of them were still alive, but they were all thrown on a pile and taken out of the city and thrown into a pit and covered with earth. The children, teenagers, girls, boys, went along stumbling and falling and begging for bread. I couldn't take it. I went home and I screamed and cried hysterically.
We survived thanks to parishioners, the railroad employees who had the chance to travel beyond the borders of Ukraine. And we had neighbors, Soviet officials. They always had food. We came through their garbage cans. We eat rotten potatoes, rotten cabbage and beets, and the scraps of food which they threw away. I am not ashamed to admit it, because it was a matter of survival. I didn't want to die.
When we reached the state farm and met the manager, he hired us to work there. He told us we would work at night, feeding the horses linseed cakes mixed with chopped straw. He said we should do this when people are asleep, because if they were awake, they would eat the horses' fodder. We said, how can we do that? People are more important than horses. But he said, we need the horses to cart the corpses away. They collected the corpses from the houses. A deep sleigh would stop at every house, and the men would ask, do you have any? Thank God, we have none. Then they'd stop at the next house. Have you got any? Yes. Well, bring them out. But I don't have the strength. Then two or three young men, themselves with swollen legs, would go into the house, bring out the corpse, and place it in the sleigh. They'd collect two, three, four a day.
In the spring, when my little sister died, her body lay in the house a whole week. We kept it until Mother came back from the state farm. People would come to our house and knock on the door every day, asking whether we had any corpses. We'd shout, no, we don't. Then the wagon would continue down the street collecting corpses. When Mother came home, we had to bury my sister. How could we bury her? There was nothing for a coffin. We wrapped her in a sheet, placed her on a sled, and took her to the cemetery. We put her between two coffins in a big grave. Coffins were placed on top also. And that's how we buried her.
Half a world away, kinsmen of the famine victims voice protests and form relief committees. Help is offered from Canada, the United States, Switzerland, France, Belgium. Cardinal Initzer initiates relief in Austria. Metropolitan Sheptytsky in western Ukraine. But all shipments of food grind to a halt at the Soviet border. The Soviet Red Cross flatly denies the existence of famine. The hands of the international organization are tied. Metropolitan Mstislav was then a deputy in the Polish parliament. He helped to organize relief efforts by Ukrainians living under Polish rule.
Our attempts to ship the grain into Ukraine were coordinated through the Soviet embassy in Warsaw. They told us this was not in their jurisdiction and that they would relay the request to the central government in Moscow. But Moscow's communications to us were, what are you doing? Why would we need grain? We have had a wonderful harvest. There is no famine of any kind. This is nothing but anti-Soviet propaganda, that's all. So they gave us no hope of any kind that the grain would ever get there.
Spring 1933. The man-made famine reaches its height. 25,000 are dying every day. 1,000 an hour. 17 human beings every minute. Thank you.
They tried to fool the people, telling them the famine was from natural causes. But the people saw that the famine was not from natural causes. No matter how hard they tried to hide the grain sealed inside mills and silos, people somehow found out there was plenty of grain, but they wouldn't give out any. Most of the grain was inside state mills. They were filled, and nobody was allowed near them. Some of it was piled high in the yard in sacks, covered with canvas, and it just rotted away. When I came to Mehedjuka that first time, all the bushes were still green, but when I came back, there was not a single leaf left. They ate it all. You couldn't hear a dog bark in the village, because they were eaten also.
We were told, children, it's very dangerous to go begging for food from house to house now. Terrible crimes are happening. You may not have heard, but a man who was going to the well for water or was coming back from the well fell and froze to death. His wife cut off pieces of his flesh and ate them.
My cousin, who was much younger than I, had three children. And those three children were eaten by their neighbors.
A directive issued by the Justice Department ensures that no official records of cannibalism are kept. All such cases are withdrawn from the courts and dealt with behind the closed doors of the OGPU secret police. Having killed a quarter of the nation's population, the Soviets staged one of the greatest cover-ups in history. At a grain conference in London, the Soviets campaigned vigorously to raise their grain export quotas from 25 to 85 million bushels of wheat. The scheme is effective. Few can imagine a state exporting grain at the cost of its own people's lives. Indignant over the mass unemployment and hardships in their own countries, many influential socialist sympathizers unwittingly rally to Moscow's defense. George Bernard Shaw and a party of leading British socialites visit the USSR and report, quite truthfully, that the restaurants where they eat are full of food. Another important foreign guest to receive the red carpet treatment is former French Prime Minister Edouard Herriot. He is actually given a five-day guided tour of Ukraine at the height of the famine. His favorable impressions of the country receive widespread publicity.
I would like to thank the government and the people of the Soviet Union for their warm reception.
Well, Johann von Herwart was a young attaché at the German embassy in Moscow, and after the Second World War, German ambassador to Great Britain. He recalls how the Soviets stage-managed Herriot's entire trip.
The famous visit of the president of the French cabinet, Herriot, when he came to Kiev, then he had the impression that everything was all right in Kiev. The streets were well cleaned, through which he drove. He got a wonderful breakfast in his hotel, and then in the streets there were trucks labeled bread, and bread was unloaded, and everything seemed to be fine. And then he went to see a collective farm, and when he spoke to the farmers, nobody knows if they were really farmers or put there just for the inspection of Herriot. They told him that everything was fine, much better than under the Tsars, and he came home and said, there's no famine in Ukraine. The peasants are very happy.
Idealized scenes of work and happy peasant life are the staple diet in Soviet movie theaters as the famine rages on.
Нам ветер светит, любит помогает,
A sensational show trial is staged in Moscow to further help distract the Soviet people from the failures of the five-year plan. Six British engineers working in the USSR face the death sentence on trumped-up charges of sabotage, espionage, and bribery. The interest the trial arouses in the West gives the Soviets extra leverage to muzzle the foreign press corps. Correspondents are bluntly told that if they want access to the trial, they are not to mention the famine in their dispatches. Having served their purpose, the British saboteurs are eventually released. Malcolm Muggeridge arrived in the USSR in 1932. He was one of the very few journalists to defy the Soviet travel ban and report on the real conditions in the countryside.
I don't think that foreigners realize sufficiently how completely the Soviet authorities can control the foreign press. The sense it worked simply that if you wrote a message, you had to take it along to the press department. I mean, the telegraph company wouldn't accept it unless it was stamped by them. You had to submit it to them. And they would read it through, and they would say, you can't say that. As I began to be very critical of the whole setup, to criticize the use of terrorism by the government, the articles that I wrote on the famine would undoubtedly, I would have had to leave, but I sent those over in a diplomatic bag. They would never have got out of the country otherwise, and I left before they had appeared.
For every article on the famine that appeared, two were published denying its existence. Muggeridge recalls the most influential correspondent in Moscow was Walter Duranty, the Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist for the New York Times.
He was not only the greatest liar among the journalists in Moscow, but he was the greatest liar of any journalist that I ever met in the 50 years of journalism. And we used to wonder whether, in fact, the authorities hadn't got some kind of hold over him, because he so utterly played their game. But it didn't worry the New York Times, who featured his reports. When it came to the famine, the great famine in the Ukraine, brought about by collectivization, that was when his reporting was particularly disgraceful, because he denied that there was any famine.
The Soviets actually grant Duranty permission to tour Ukraine unchaperoned. He reports in the Times that all talk of famine now is ridiculous. Yet documents from the British Foreign Office reveal that in private conversations at the British Embassy, Duranty said as many as 10 million people had died.
When they were discussing the question of recognizing Soviet Union, the United States government recognizing the Soviet Union, the articles of Duranty were considered as very valuable evidence on the side of recognition.
Shortly after Soviet Foreign Minister Maxim Litvinov visits Washington in November 1933, the U.S. recognizes the Soviet government and enters agreements securing a balance of trade in favor of the United States. The following year, the Soviet cover-up achieves its ultimate success, a seat in the League of Nations. And this in spite of the fact Western governments knew all about the famine.
The government of Weimar, the democratic government, was well aware of what was going on in the Soviet Union. But the attitude of the government was, I would say, you could call it passive. And with the younger ones of the embassy, we always were of the opinion then at that period that we ought not to have any commercial relations with a criminal government which allowed hundreds of thousands and even millions of people to starve. The government said we had already great unemployment in Germany, and if we stopped delivering the manufactured goods to the Soviet Union would increase unemployment in Germany. That was the situation.
Trade relations take precedence. The famine is regarded as a strictly internal Soviet affair. The Western governments make their peace with genocide. The communist writer Mykola Chlyava reacts to the destruction of his people by starvation, the mass arrests of his friends and party members by taking his life. The party strongman Nikola Skripnik is denounced as an enemy of the state. He, too, commits suicide.
These suicides came to symbolically represent the end of an epoch in the history of Ukraine. Up to that time, we believed that a normal national development was possible. As they taught us, a culture socialist in content and national in form.
Stalin ends the famine with a single decree. Having broken the Ukrainian farmers, he can afford to give out grain on the collectives during the harvest in 1933. 1934, purges take place in the cities and mark the end of Ukrainian participation in the running of their country. 27,000 Ukrainian communists are arrested and replaced by Russians. Only 36 out of 259 Ukrainian writers survive as the terror intensifies. The jail cells are rapidly emptied as Ukrainian nationalism becomes an offense punishable by death. The purges stop when the Nazis invade Ukraine in June 1941. Millions perish as Hitler attempts to replace Stalin's shackles with his own. To divert attention away from their own brutalities, the Nazis invite an international commission to inspect the mass graves left from Soviet rule. In the town of Vinnytsia alone, the commission uncovers the bodies of over 9,000 brutally murdered farmers, workers, poets, priests. No one can estimate the full total of those who disappeared in Stalin's reign of terror. She never adapted to wearing chains. The Soviet Union denies to this day the famine ever took place, but the harvest of despair cannot ever be forgotten.